Good day, everybody, and welcome to the second qualifying session of the DGTL 12-hour race. We're very sorry for the short delay, but now we're here. And in the meantime, what's happening is I'm going to speak some of the qualifying session here, and seeing that I'm racing a car, actually, I will be trying to hand over the commentary to my friend Jan later on. So, with that being said, you're all very welcome to this 12-hour race. I hope you're going to enjoy some nice racing. Certainly, the field has proven to be very, very close indeed. As of course mentioned before and on the website, the race we are going to do today is a 12-hour online race off Sebring. There we go. At the moment, these are the contestants on the server. This is the second qualifying session, so we drove another one last night. Therefore, these times are not the final times. Some people have said better times yesterday. But on the server right now, we have the team Kitty DK. And that team is consisting of DGTL Regidon Nikolai Pedersen and a new guy I haven't seen before called Hamza Lia Mikko. Also on the server we have a team called BAS, which is Black Arrow Sim Sport, I think. Black Arrow Sim Sport consists of Henrik Heuer, the current DGTL leader in the LMP category, and along with him, Martin Eldale, as I remember it. No, sorry, that's not right. Racing together with Henrik Heuer is a guy going by the nickname of Santana. His name is Carsten da Silva. So, surprisingly, actually, the Team Kitty car is quicker than the Epsilon car, which has proven very superior in the DGTL series with Henrik Heuer behind the wheel. The FTZ car is back as well. The FTZ car consists of team leader Henning Petersen and one of his guys. I can't remember which one of them he's racing with. Then we move into the GT1 category. Here with the list of Storm GT. That is actually my own car. Our car consists of me, Lasse Jacobi Aargaard, and my teammate, Peter Munkholm. At the moment, the Formula Yamaha car advertising for a new go-kart class in Denmark, actually. We are running a pole position with a time of 153.078, which is the quickest time at the moment. It's quicker than was run yesterday. Second position in GT1 is the 10-man project. Ted and Project consists of our two usual Lamborghini drivers, Christian Johansson and Kasper Hogård. They have opted to drive a Ford GT this time around, and they are running in second position, as you can tell. Also, in the GT field, which has proven to be surprisingly big, actually, we have the team called Team Bernie Racing. Team Bernie consists of the two brothers, Michael and Brian Bernberg, and they are running third position at the moment. They've been by a very, very, very tiny margin, as you can tell, by 0.03 of a second. They've been knocked off second position in GT1. Bear in mind, this is endurance racing, and qualifying is just for show. It doesn't mean anything. Also on the server, in 7th position, is the team called Team Easyon. Team Easyon running a Lola LMP car, LMP1. That is actually a single-man team consisting of a guy, I think, consisting of a guy called Jeppe Vestergaard Rasmussen. And as far as we know, he's racing alone. He's going to do the entire 12 hours on his own. So, if he pulls that off, quite an Iron Man. Then there's the number 8 car, on the server at least, Steen Steinecke. Another just one car. Steen Steinecke, another DGTL regular in our league, racing the green Lamborghini. Who he's racing with in the 12 hour race, I'm not entirely sure, but Steen Steinecke has proved to be quite competitive. Also, returning from the 24 hours of Le Mans, we have Team Kolding Racing. It's the number 3 car, so their front car that has returned. The number 3 car of Team Kolding, that consists of Ben Juul and one of his teammates, Brian Nielsen, I think his name is. To be honest, Team Kolding Racing in the slower part of the field at the moment. Just behind them is the German Corvette, raced by Frank Kaubeck and Jan Strunk. And at the moment they are the slowest GT1 car, but it should be said that compared to yesterday's qualification, these guys have improved almost 3 seconds. So a huge improvement on their part, albeit still being the slowest car in the GT1 field. So, that is the field on the server as of now. the race is going to start at 12 o'clock, so in a little under half an hour. We're going to see the usual do with the safety car, as we do it in the G2R 24-hour race off Le Mans, and the DGTL races. The first lap will be a formation lap behind the safety car, and then the rest of the race will be given loose after the safety car enters the pit lane after the first formation lap. Here we see the Formula Yamaha car going for a new shot at the pole position. Already a bit in front of the other cars, but during the practice sessions we have seen some of the cars run considerably faster than they are doing at the moment. This particular Lister Storm race car we have seen doing a time of around 1 minute 52 seconds and a half, half a second. So still almost half a second off that time at the moment. The conditions for going that quickly aren't really, to be honest, warm enough to go much quicker. here is actually a good chance to just have a short view of the track. This is the first corner, in some cases called Sunset Corner. No, sorry, that's the last corner, stupid. That is the first corner, going out to corner number 2, 3, and 4 and 5 here. This is a long right-hander, very quick, called Green Park. Going down to corner number 7, a slow chicane, very hard on the brakes. Make an early apex, oh, bugger. You make an early apex there, to give you the ability to go really quickly onto the next bit of straight leading up to the corner called Defend Your Chicane. Anyway, we'll just find a car that is actually racing. Here we are on board with the German Corvette. As I was saying, here's our corners number 4 and 5. Then the long right-hander passing on the right-hander, what's called Green Park. Under the bridge, hard under brakes under the 400 yard sign. Make an early apex and then hard on the throttle. Again, as early and as hard as you can. Then we're accelerating onto this little piece here, this quick right left thing is called the Fentures Cane. And here comes what is called the Cunningham Corner, corner number 10, quickly followed by corner number 11 and into this long left called the Collier Curve. Then there's this right turner, exit is very important in this corner, that wasn't really the best exit I've seen. That's corner number, that was corner number 13, and it's called a tower turn. Then we are going out to the Bishop Bend, turn number 14, or through turn number 15 now, and here comes turn number 16. Very important, the exit here. Early apex, hard on the throttle to get on to the what is called the Ullman Strait, which is actually a piece of old runway. Bear in mind, Sebring is actually a training facility for bomber pilots during the Second World War. Here, this long, very quick right hand leading up to start finish straight. That is the corner that is called Sunset Corner, Sunset Bend. Given its name because when the sun starts to come down, it is of course an old runway, so you are going directly west, racing down the back straight. That also means when the sun is setting, you're getting the sun right in your face. And that can make it very difficult to see the already vague entrance to this corner, the sunset corner. Also notice... We have just seen Black Arrow SimSport take back the pole position, and they have done so with a margin of 1/1000th of a second. So, a superior one run from Black Arrow SimSport there, but not by a huge margin, to be fairly honest. No kidding aside, that's really impressive. It's very, very rare we see such small margins between times. But it's nice to see that the Black Arrow SimSport car, the Epsilon car, is actually able to go that fast, because we haven't actually seen them go anywhere near as quick as the Audi R15 of Team Kitty. And here, of course, the Team Kitty car. And I think you can guess why the team name is what it is. To be fair with you, not the most manly car I've ever seen, but never mind if they're going quick enough, who cares? Oh, and the kiddie car overshooting here, and they have to take the old number 7 corner. The old number 7 corner is actually a very nice opportunity for you to run off without damaging the car, because it is a corner that people are braking very late for, and should you make a mistake, the remains of the old number 7 corner gives you plenty of ability to overshoot without damaging your car. Oof, quite a big shot for the kiddie car there. Fortunately, this is only sim racing, so their car will be ready in due time for the race. Regarding this Team Kitty Team Black Arrow SimSport thing, looking through the times of yesterday's qualification, you could actually see that the Black Arrow SimSport Epsilon, they haven't actually taken back the pole position. They are still over half a second behind, because yesterday evening the Team Kitty car did a time of 1:44.6. So that means that the Black Arrow SimSport car is actually over 0.6 of a second slower still, and they have some catching up to do. Still very impressive to see that they're this close together. And another interesting thing happening now here is the Team Ezion car, the Lola, even though they are an LMP1 car, they have done exactly the same time as the Formula Yamaha Lister now. And this Lola LMP car has actually done precisely the same time, down to a thousandth of a second. I'm really surprised we're seeing so many close lap times during this qualification. But it does make for some nice racing, you have to say that. Of course, given that it is an LMP car, they have to go quicker to be a serious contestant for the pole position. But nonetheless, impressive. Car in the picture here, the 10-man project for GT, that is their pole position sitter at the moment in GT1, because yesterday they did a time of 1:53.06, and the Lister Storm Formula Yamaha car has done 1:53.07. So again, hundredths of second dividing cars. But that does actually mean that this Ford GT just exiting the pits now. They are in front of the former Yamaha car here. So the two pole positions at the moment in the two classes is the team Kitty car in LMP1, with a time driven yesterday of 1:44.6, and pole sitter in GT1 is the 10-man project Ford GT, with a time of 1:53.067 ahead of the Formula Yamaha car with a time of 1:53.078. So really very, very small margins during this qualification. For the history interested ones of you out there, there is actually quite a bit of history on the Sebring circuit. Sebring circuit is officially called the Sebring International Raceway. It is in very nearly the middle of the state Florida in the United States. Sebring Raceway is a very old raceway, actually built on top of an old airbase or airfield. The airfield was built very quickly in 1941. As I remember it, the order for starting to build Sebring airfield or airbase, that was in September of 1941. And in October or November, the first soldiers moved in, and they were living in tents off the site before the first barracks were actually built. So as was the norm during the Second World War, very, very, very quick job, a lot of effort put into building it quickly. The Air Force Base was a training facility, and at its peak it housed, as I remember it, around 100,000 people, and 100 Boeing B-17s were used for aircrew training. after the war, of course, many training facilities weren't necessary anymore. And that meant that in 1946, the Air Force base was no longer used as a training facility. Very shortly thereafter, racing actually began on the Sebring circuit. The first race was ever on the Sebring circuit was done in 1950 on New Year's Eve, actually, of 1950. The first 12-hour race, comparable to the one we do now, each year in March, of course, that was done in 1952. The 15th of March 1952, and the racetrack grew all along the years. Sebring's layout has been the way it is for a very long time, actually. It consists of parts of old runway. The bottom Ullman straight, that is actually a part of a very wide runway used during the pilot training for the bomber crews. And many of the roads between the runways have been used for the racetrack. Some of them were personnel and vehicle roads. Some of them, as far as I know, were taxiways for the airplanes. But anywho, it meant that the Sebring circuit is very, very rough and very bumpy, because the runways and many of the taxiways, they were built using concrete blocks. So as you can clearly tell, if you can find a car going onto the straight, you can see this car is... you can see this part of the track is very clearly huge concrete blocks cemented together. That makes for a very challenging experience, because the circuit being as bumpy as it is, you have to put a lot of work into getting your suspension and your dampening working just right for you to be quick, but still keeping the car stable enough as to not that it will catch you off guard and spin you around. So one of the main challenges of Sebring is definitely the track surface. Concrete blocks again, and this was the part of the old runway I was talking about. Most of the pit and paddock area to your right, that's actually also old runway. This bottom straight, or the back straight, is just only around a fifth of the width of the original runway. So a lot of the area you saw on the right side, and again here on the right side of the racetrack, that is actually an old part of the runway called 0927. So that runway was directly east-west, which is, of course, the reason why the corner at the end of the straight is called Sunset Corner, because you get your sun in directly into your eyes when the sun's setting. Thank you. The Black Arrow SimSport car heading into the pits now. We are very nearly going to move on to the race in just a few minutes. The Black Arrow SimSport car not able to get into the 1 minute 44s. So a bit of a disappointment on their part, but still, as I said, qualification doesn't really matter with regards to the end results of the race. For your information, the real track in its current layout is 5.95 kilometers, and the track record in real life is 1 minute 43 seconds 0.2, and that was set by Sebastian Bourdais in the Peugeot 908 in the 2009, during the 2009 race, or in the qualifying session before the race. So still, our LMP cars is a bit off the margin. And, more or less there. And the time of 1 minute 44, which the Team Kitty car has actually done yesterday, that is very respectable. And also by far the quickest we've seen yet. Seems like all the cars are in the pit lane now, preparing for the beginning of the race. It is actually now 12 o'clock, and we are awaiting that the session will be moved on. Indeed, all the cars are now in the pit lane, awaiting the change to the next session. One thing that is being discussed at the moment is whether the Formula Yamaha car or the 10-man project car have the quickest lap time. There's been some dispute too that the 1 minute for 1 minute. The 1 minute 53.06 time that the 10-man project has registered from yesterday is actually has been driven outside the envelope of the official qualifying session, which ran from 8 o'clock to midnight yesterday. That is it now. We have moved on to the race session. There is 1 minute and 30 seconds for the car to get on the grid now. What we will see then is that the cars will arrange behind the safety car, and then they will do a single safety car lap. Then the safety car will exit the track, and they will be driven. The race will be driven. I think that's quite interesting at the moment. The track surface seems to be damp, as you can tell by behind this Lister Storm just testing out very quickly. And here are some of the cars aligning on the grid already. Team Ishan, a Lola LMP car. the team Bernie Racing. Ferrari 550 lining up. 10-man project still in the pits. Team Kolding Racing is on the grid. Steen Steinecke, the Ford GT, Steen Steinecke is on the grid as well. Frank Kaubrick and Jan Strunk still in the pit lane, but they should be coming out in just a moment. Then there's the safety car, which of course will overtake all the cars before the race will begin. Before this is the outlap will begin, sorry. It should probably just be mentioned that the cars should be starting in the order that they have qualified in total. The order they are arranged in now isn't actually the order in which they are arranged, which is why you will see some swapping of positions during this early part of the safety car lap. As you can tell, the Black Arrow SimSport car has moved into second position, which is its rightful position, because the team Kitty car, the Audi R15 here, did a time of 1 minute 44 something, which is a lot quicker than the Black Arrow SimSport car. Then third position we have the FTZ car. The Pole GT1 car is the 10-man project. Right behind them is the former Yamaha Lister Storm GT. Then we have the LMP car from Team Ezion, the Iron Man one-handed race from Jeppe Rasmussen. Then there's the Team Bernie Racing Ferrari 550, then the Team Kolding Racing Aston Martin DBR9. Then we have the Steen Steinecke 4GT, and it seems that the German Coveter hasn't actually gone out on the track. I don't know why that is. I don't know if you can tell, but as said earlier, the track surface is slightly damp, which could be an advantage for the petrol-powered Epsilon car, as diesel cars can be very tricky to handle in the wet. That being said, the amount of water on the track is very, very little, and we are expecting to see it dry up as the cars begin to race. The cars are now going onto back straight. Here is the last one before the straight. The cars are heading onto the back straight, the old runway, going now to Sunset Bend. Then they would go around the bend, and oh, there seems to be some calamity here. What is that? Did the little stone car get this? Yes, it did actually get a small bump. That means one of the headlights have come off. I'm not sure whether or not. I'm not sure whether or not that means that the little stone will have to go in to get some new headlights fixed. I think he collided with the 10-man project Coveter GT, but there's no really visible damage on that car. And with that being said, the race has been given loose. Team KD car is veering in front, closely breathing down their neck is the Black Arrow SimSport car. And these two cars have already put out a huge gap to the FTZ car on third position. than the already leading GT1, this 10-man project car. With the cars getting up to speed here, you can just tell the slight water precipitation on the track surface, but it's very, very little. So not something we're expecting to see affect the lap times by a lot in any way. The Formula Yamaha car and the 10-man project car very close together indeed. Then comes the Team Bernie Racing car, the Ferrari 550, already a bit behind the two front runners. The Lola LMP1 here seems to be running with a lot of downforce, as down the straight it couldn't really pull away from the Aston Martin. Granted, the Aston Martin is riding the slipstream, but that LMP car should be able to go faster, so they must be running a lot of wing, which might give them an advantage in the corner. We did just see the safety car on the track still. I am suspecting that that might be because the German car of Frank Kalbeck and Jan Strunk didn't have a chance to get on the starting grid. The reason sort of why that is still unknown to me. But that is... Even though it's a shame that the race is probably going to restart it, I don't know, but I think that's what's going to happen. That does bring some good news with it, and it's for the 10-man project car and the Formula Yamaha car. It means that they can get their aero damage fixed while the race is being restarted. The safety car at the moment. On the corner entering the back straight. Hasn't really picked up the LMP cars yet. The LMP cars still on the inside part of the track. Going through the Cunningham corner here, as I remember it. Then the old Kolding curve and here the tower turn. And the LMP cars as well heading for the back straight now. Blackout Simford car has gotten themselves in front, so we might. It already seems that they are going to set a higher race pace. The safety car now on the start finish straight. And the leading LMP1 car quickly catching up the Black Arrow Simsport car. They should be picked up by the safety car now. And Lago seems to have car indeed setting down his speed. So they have been picked up now. It seems Kitty car been picked up. We're waiting for the FT set car to be picked up. So, in a moment we're going to see what you German viewers would probably call Stau. It's not often that you see a guy in a Corvette causing a queue, but nevertheless. FTZ car nearly catching up now, going down to corner number 7, the chicane. Now the FTZ car has been picked up as well, so all our LMP entries are behind the safety car now. Very quickly thereafter, you see the 10-man project 4GT is also in the field now. And the Pablo Yamaha very closely followed by the Ferrari is also picked up, along with the load over the left downforce. The Steinsteiniger GG car getting a bit out of the way here. He's just getting back into place. And now the Iron Man, so to speak, Lola car's been picked up, and the Sean Kolding racing car's been picked up. That is the entire field. Now beyond the safety car. As I said, not quite sure as to what the reason is that we are behind the safety car, but I suspect that it's because the German Corvette C6R, raced by Frank Kauberg and Jan Strunk, didn't have a chance to get on the grid. Probably they had some kind of technical problem. Indeed, it was the German car that fell off the server, which meant they didn't have a chance to start. What is going on now? People will just be given a few seconds to find their setups, and then we're going to restart the race in exactly the same manner that we saw before. As you can tell, the German Corvette is with us again now, and we are hoping that they will stay with us a little longer. One thing that of course is an element when changing track is that the track conditions have now changed, so going from a damp, slightly wet track before, we now have a circuit that is very, very hot indeed. I might just show you that the track temperature right now is 32 degrees, which is quite hot for racing temperatures. Yesterday's qualification session was 29 degrees. So, there's our timetable back again. there goes the next session. That is the qualification session. We will move on again, and at a time more. That is qualifying 2, what we drove today. What was before was qualifying 1, what we drove yesterday evening. In the dark, of course. Race, of course, starting at 12 o'clock, even though it's 19 past 12 o'clock at the moment. That also means that we will see racing in both daylight and in dark conditions. There goes the next session again. So we are now again in the race session. We're waiting for the race to be restarted. Let's just check out the temperatures. The temperatures are actually very hot now, with an ambient temperature of 24 and a track temperature of 34 degrees. As you can tell, the German Covetti car now on the starting grid, which was the point of this whole exercise. They fell off the server. That is the rules. If somebody have a crash, they fall off the server, they lose their internet connection. We do a restart in the hope that everybody will finish the entire 12 hours of racing.